Welcome. This session will show you how to make C# scripts and functions accessible within Unity Visual Scripting, the different ways you can create custom Visual Scripting nodes, and how to bring events or variables created with Visual Scripting into C# scripts. Hi everyone, Ashley Alicea here from Unity's Developer Advocate team. For this Unite Now session, we're going to talk about a few of the ways programmers can use Unity Visual Scripting alongside C# when working in teams that need advanced Visual Scripting functionality or an easy way to work with existing project scripts. You can grab the project files at the link below to follow along. If you're new to Unity Visual Scripting, also known as Bolt, and need a primer before this demo, be sure to check out our previously released Unite Now session introducing Bolt, Unity's new Visual Scripting tool, and also our roadmap updates over in our Visual Scripting forums. With that said, let's get to it. Before we jump into Unity, let's quickly talk about why you would use these Unity Visual Scripting plus C# workflows. Working with Visual Scripting is often a matter of personal preference, and everything we're showing in this session is aimed for creators who want a visual way to see game logic in action, or for those who work with artists, designers, and other creatives that use Visual Scripting as their way to make project contributions. If you prefer to work with code in an IDE and don't have to worry about making your scripts approachable to non-programmers, you can totally stick with C#. If you personally rather stick to Visual Scripting, you can do that too. You don't just have to pick one though. When you use them together, you can empower people on your team to work more independently and reduce the time spent implementing design, art, etc. requests into scripts. Let's take a look with our first example where we'll implement C# functions into a Visual Scripting graph to create a shooting behavior for a spaceship game prototype. Right now, the prototype has a little futuristic city and a spaceship we can fly around using a gamepad or keyboard. I'm working with some designers who are using Visual Scripting for this project, and they want to set up some game logic for a spaceship shooting ability. While they already have some Visual Scripting logic set up for the spaceship movement, they don't really want to mess with aspects of a shooting system like object pooling. They just want a way to have a projectile shoot when the correct input is detected, and the ability to change things like rate of fire or add additional logic to the behavior. For this, we have a few scripts set up and attached to our spaceship prefab. The first is this player spaceship shooting behavior script that has a shoot projectile function to grab and position a projectile from our object pool, which we're managing with this object pool behavior script. We also have a spaceship data scriptable object that is handling the values coming in from the new input system, and it's what our designers will use to know when the input for shooting is active. Let's get the base shooting behavior set up in a super unit, which is essentially a flow graph that can be nested into other flow graphs as a single unit. Super units are also one of the ways you can approach creating custom units or nodes for your team to use. To set one up, create a new flow graph asset, open it using the graph window, and use the graph inspector to add any inputs or outputs your unit will require. For this example, we need a control input and control output to handle the graph's logic flow, and a float value input to establish the rate of fire for our shooting behavior. We can add these inputs and outputs to the graph using nesting input and output units. Now let's go ahead and add our shoot projectile function. Since its script exists in the global namespace, it will automatically be accessible in our graph when we right-click and use the unit finder. Once we select it, it appears as a unit within our graph and has a flow input and output, along with a field to reference the script component, which we'll leave as self. Our designers could technically use this as is, but we want to apply a rate of fire so that the player doesn't spawn a constant stream of projectiles. We'll quickly add some nodes to calculate the time between shots using some math, time, variable, and branch units, and connect them all together. Note that we'll take the rate of fire float input our designers will pass a value into and connect that to this add node that helps calculate the projectile timing. We're now ready to hand this off to our designers to use in their main visual scripting flow machine for the spaceship's behaviors. We can select the player prefab in our hierarchy to open the main visual scripting graph for our spaceship. We have the logic here already for the ship's movement, but we can pan down to an empty area in our graph to add our shooting logic. Let's start with a fixed update unit and add a branch to verify if the player is pressing the input for shooting. We can get this information from a Boolean in our spaceship data scriptable object, which we have defined in our visual scripting scene variables. Just like we did earlier to find a function, we can also use the finder to get variables from our scripts. After adding getShootInput, we'll connect the scriptable object it needs to reference to its input and connect its Boolean output to our branch unit. We want our shooting logic to occur when shootInput is true. So continuing from the true float output, we'll add in our super unit. We need to pass in a float for our rate of fire, so let's add a new float graph variable and connect that to the super unit. Entering play mode, not only can we see our logic works great, but we can also see the graph flow passing through our chain of events in the graph window. Our designers are now free to customize this shooting behavior however they please, like adding some classic pew 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 laser sounds to play for each projectile that gets fired. In our next example, let's take a look at another way you can create custom units, this time using just a C# function, and how to add a script to be used by visual scripting if it doesn't appear in the finder. Some folks on my team are setting up these rings in our scene for our player to fly through for a speed boost power-up. Their visual scripting logic for handling this is almost complete, but one of our artists asked if we could make a single unit for customizing the effect of the trails coming from the spaceship's wingtips. We can, so let's open the existing player spaceship effects behavior script we're using to manage the current trail effects and add a new function called customize trail. We want our artist to easily customize the length, width, and color of the trail effect. So we'll add two floats and a color value to pass through as parameters. We'll then set up additional variables to define our parameters, and using a for each loop, we'll apply our new values to each trail renderer. Lastly, we'll also set up a reset trail function that can reset all the values we just defined back to their default values. Let's go add this to our visual scripting graph. Opening the finder, I'll type in customize trail. But you'll see no options appear for us to use. That's because our script is using a different namespace. But this is quick to resolve. Navigate to Tools, Bolt, Unit Options Wizard. It will open up the window used to set your assemblies and types back when you first installed Bolt Visual Scripting. Over in the Type section, click the plus sign to add a new type and search for the script you want to reference. In our case, Player Spaceship Effects Behavior. Press Generate, and once it's done, you can go back to your graph and use the finder to apply the function we just created. We'll connect it to the existing graph logic and apply the values it needs. Since we're referencing our player prefab, we'll plug in our variable that references that game object. We don't want these changes to be applied to our trails forever. So let's also add our reset trail function to the graph logic here that ends the speed boost effect. Let's test this in play mode. Excellent. Our artists can now tweak the values as they need it from here. One more helpful tip before we wrap this example up. If you need to rename a member or type you're using in a visual scripting graph, know that you can remap the new name to the original one using the renamed from attribute so your graphs don't break. So I demonstrated two ways you can create custom visual scripting units. But technically speaking, a super unit is a nested graph, and adding a function to your graph creates a C# reflection unit. That said, it is possible to create your own true custom visual scripting units. We're currently in the process of updating our visual scripting documentation to bring clarity to this process, and do know that future updates to the feature may change this workflow slightly. But for now, here's a quick and general preview on custom unit creation. Let's look back at that set of nodes we set up earlier for playing random audio clips for our laser shooting behavior. Instead of using these random range and get item units as part of this logic, let's create a custom unit that can receive an audio clip list input, then randomly pick and output one of the audio clips in the list. We'll start by creating a new script in our assets folder called pick random audio clip. Open it up and add the namespaces for Ludic and Bolt. From there, we'll add an attribute to define a category for this unit to appear under in the Finder window, and another to give it a subtitle for helpful context on what this unit will do. Let's also set our class to inherit from the unit type instead of mono behavior. We then need to define the variables for our unit's inputs and outputs. We also need to ensure they're not serialized as they get redefined each time the unit is reserialized. Since we're working with a list and audio clip, we'll also add variables for those too. In order for our inputs and outputs to appear, we'll need to override the method called definition. Within this override, we can define each input and output with a string for their label on the unit and the values they need, if applicable. Within the function we'll apply for our control input, we'll get the current flow and return an output port. For the value output, we'll grab the audio clip list brought in from our value input and define the audio clip we want to return from the list with a randomized index. Now we just need to go back to the editor and go to Tools, Bolt, Update Unit Options so we can use it in our graph. As we open the Finder, we can see the custom category we defined and our unit is right inside. We'll replace the units we worked with earlier with our new custom unit and verify it works in play mode. Sounds just like before, so now we're all set with our custom unit. Again, small example for the sake of a simple demo, but you can expand these custom units to be much more complex and useful for your team's needs. Let's continue to our final example, bringing events and variables created within visual scripting into a C# script using the visual scripting events and variables APIs. With Unity Visual Scripting, you can create custom event units to trigger logic in your graphs. These units also support custom arguments. Let's set one up within our spaceship behavior graph to play a particle effect on our ship whenever we pass through one of the speed boost rings and call it boost visual. Let's also add one to the argument count so we can pass in a value to change the color of the particles to match our custom trail effect. Now, it's possible to call this custom event within your graph using a custom event trigger unit, but we can also call it from within our C# scripts. Going back to our player spaceship effects behavior script, we first need to add the namespaces we'll need to access the events and variables APIs, using Ludic and using Bolt. Then, in our customize trail function, we'll add custom event trigger, the game object with the custom event we want to reference, the name of the custom event, and the custom argument we'll pass in. That's all we need. So now we can go back to our game and see our particle effect appear as we pass through the speed boost. For working with variables, let's apply the speed boost multiplier on the rings to the start speed of the ship's particle effect. For this, we need to add in a variable for our speed multiplier, a reference to the particle system's main module, and since the speed boost multiplier for each ring is different, we'll also add an onTriggerEnter function so we can update the value for our multiplier as we fly through each ring. Now we can apply the value of the speed boost multiplier object variable that's on a ring to our speed mult variable. Since visual scripting variables are not strongly typed, we'll need to cast them manually. So we'll add float, the scope needed to access the variable on the ring we collided with, and the visual scripting variable we want to get, speed boost multiplier. Once that's defined, we just need to apply our new speed mult value to our particle system's start speed. In play mode, we can now see the speed of the particle effect changes as we fly through each ring. As a final quick note, Know that you can access visual scripting graph, scene, application, and save variables as well. The steps slightly vary for each one, but you can find all the info you need for this on the Variables API page in our documentation. With that, I'll leave you with some resources to help bring more context to what we've covered in this session. They include links to the full documentation for Unity Visual Scripting, as well as specific links for the events and variables APIs we covered. You can also grab the project files for the demo we reviewed, along with other relevant projects, through our Visual Scripting Samples repo. Lastly, you can catch the latest Visual Scripting news and updates, or post questions of your own, over on the Visual Scripting section of the Unity forums. I hope this primer helped clarify the possibilities of what you and your teams can achieve by customizing and extending Unity Visual Scripting. Thanks again for tuning in, and I wish you all the best in your game-making adventures. Take care, and see you next time.